Good morning. Welcome to the 54th season of the Utah Shakespeare Festival. Have you heard that before this week from a few people? Well, it's something to shout out about, I think. Absolutely. My name's Nancy Milich, and I am here with you every morning of this season except Mondays. We aren't here on Mondays in the Grove because our marching orders are to talk about the plays that were presented the day before. And as many of you longtime visitors know, we don't have shows on Sundays, so hence not on Monday. I've tried to tell them we could find something to talk about on Monday, but so be it. 9 o'clock hour reserved for talking about the shows that are on the outdoor stage. That would be this morning talking about Henry IV Part 2. And at 10 o'clock hour, we will be talking about, we always talk at the 10 o'clock hour about the shows on the indoor stage. That will be Charlie's Aunt today. We will be talking to David Ivers, the director of that production, at 10 o'clock hour. We are also live streaming these literary seminars preview week and opening week. So I like to tell the audience that anything you say is recorded for posterity, and people can quote you and quote you and quote you for the next 50 years. You can see those live streaming podcasts if you go to our website, bard.org, and look at them beyond today. I want to also acknowledge Tina and Larry Howard, who are and the Utah Humanities, who are in part funding sources for these seminars, and I'd like to publicly thank them for their ongoing support of these literary seminars. Thank you. Yes. Also want to acknowledge my very capable assistant, Bailey Smith, who is with me all season. Bailey is from Pullman, Washington. She will be starting her sophomore year at Southern Utah University, and we are together the rest of the season, and she is the reason that this works, in addition to you, but she's here in the early hours setting things up. Also want to acknowledge Josh Stavros, who is Associate Artistic Director here at the Associate Education Director here at the festival and the director of the Green Show. He is the person who sets this this business up here every morning, and I don't know where he's gone, but anyway, Josh Stavros is the live stream editor, correct? Okay, now sitting next to me is a person some of you know, and if you didn't know him before this season, anyone here this morning for the very first time to the Utah Shakespeare Festival? Welcome. And where are you from? Los Angeles. All right. Well, I'll talk to you for a moment to introduce this man, because everyone else apparently knows who he is. Brian Vaughn is artistic director, one of two artistic directors here at the festival. He is also an actor and a director, and you will see him, if you haven't already, as Petruchio in the current production of Taming of the Shrew, and he's the director of last night's production of Henry IV Part 2. Brian Vaughn has been here, has portrayed Prince Hal, has portrayed Hotspur, has portrayed Henry V, has played Hamlet, almost as well as anyone here at the festival. He also was with the Milwaukee Repertory Theater for 13 seasons. Last season, you saw him as the baker in Into the Woods and as Watson in the Sherlock Holmes play, The Final Adventure. So Brian knows a lot about theater. And he also knows a great deal about the Henry plays, which we are in the fourth production of the Henry cycle. And Brian directed last season's Henry IV Part 1 and Henry IV Part 2. So with that, welcome, Brian Vaughn.
Thank you.
In 1981, 82, and 83, this festival presented the three Henry plays in succession. With the same actor playing Prince Hal, James Horton. And once again, it's happening here where we have the same actor, Sam Ashdown, playing Prince Hal. And so I was thinking about this, Brian, since you know the show, the plays, the Shakespeare plays so well, and have been in them. You weren't in Henry IV Part Two. We've only done that once here previously.
Yeah.
As you started directing last year, the Henry IV Part One, and now Henry IV Part Two, do you approach it as you remember being Prince Hal and Hotspur when you started to direct? Or are you able to kind of let the actor in you go?
Well, because so much time has sort of gone by, it's easier to sort of let that go a little bit. But certainly it has informed the psychological journey of the characters, having been inside them. And really in Henry IV Part One, because I think that play really informed so much to come in this play too. I guess that's sort of a misnomer, but so yes and no. You know, as far as the directing side of it, it's mostly about storytelling and telling a concise, clear version of what this is with this group of people and this group of artists and here now for this audience in this space. So the immediacy of it really becomes about just doing it now. But I would be lying if I said that those experiences haven't informed my point of view on what the characters are and who they will become and so forth. So it's a little bit of both, I think.
So in this production, you have the character Rumor, who tells a false rumor at the beginning.
Yeah.
And the play is filled with characters who do tell false, spread false rumors. And you also started, we see Hotspur back on stage fighting Hal. How did that come about to do it that way?
Well, the part two is a very different play than part one. You see Shakespeare trying to have similar thematic structural elements that are similar to part one. A lot of the scenes, you can sort of feel a little bit of, oh, that's similar to the first play, but completely not the same. It's a much darker, much more reflective play in part two. And I think what Shakespeare is really trying to do by showing them side by side is showing that the first play is really about youth and vitality and this sort of examination of much age and disease and decay and people falling away and what that means for, in this case, England as a whole, as a nation. And these people are sort of representatives of that on all status of their life. The rumor side of things, it was just one of those things you read it and you go, this is very odd. This is an induction scene where it's sort of like when last we saw Henry on Henry IV Part One, it kind of brings the audience up to speed with what had happened, but framing it in this way that is a false report to try to show that rumor and this sort of sinful slander is beginning to sort of weave its way through the kingdom is becoming present. And I think that Shakespeare's way of initially going, things are not what you thought they were going to be. And because of the events at the Battle of Shrewsbury, this negative persona is still going to try to infiltrate Henry's mind, body, and spirit of England. And that becomes Hal's psychological journey through the course of all of these plays, is his adoption of justice to turn away anarchy. And he himself is a product of both of those worlds, straddling both of them. And what he does in the next play, Henry V, how he conquers that sensibility. The main thing that I think is really fascinating and about Hal and that journey is his quest for identity. And it's something you see in Henry V that he struggles with much more profoundly than in the other two plays, and that is the sense of his right legitimacy to being in the seat of England. And he says it in the last scene with his father. We see it in Henry V of him playing the role of king, kind of, and then him really adopting that after the Battle at Agincourt, when he goes in front of his troops and begins to have a sense of true self in the role. And that's sort of woven in this play And I think it's sometimes hard to digest because it doesn't have as much action as part one. Something I put in my director's notes is the battles in this play are internal, and they're about people in change and on the brink of change and how they weather that in the midst of transition and failing health in a family and what that means for the generations to come. But this rumor thing, you know, I really looked at it as sort of trying to bookend what that is in the play and what's going to happen in the next play with sort of the true-false idea of who Hal is, and beginning the play with this sort of iconic or this image of this sort of shadowy figure, which to me that's why there's the mask, and Hotspur is a masked character, that there is no identity for those characters anymore, just how Hal sits in the middle of that in this sort of puppet master weaving this retelling of that event, became to me more about Shakespeare saying truth and fiction, starting the play with a false representation of history, which is another irony there, knowing Shakespeare himself is weaving his own form of history, and then ending the play with a character that will do nothing but tell the truth, and that is the chorus in Henry V, and that being the same actor that's also playing Henry. Was interesting to me that there's a father-son thing that is permanent and lasting both now and to come for Hal in the journey. And you'll see, if you, those of you that haven't seen Henry V or those of you that do, that chorus character really becomes the audience and becomes the mouthpiece for history. And that to me I thought would be really interesting in this particular production, was bookending that with a sense of false and then truth sort of coming in, fiction and truth bookended. So that's where that came. And also trying to solve this thing that is like, who is this? You know, Shakespeare says rumor and induction, rumor painted with tongues is what it says. And what that means, you know, you take as you will. So many productions have the entire cast up there sort of retelling this. Sometimes that is cut completely. The play also ends with an epilogue that is spoken by a young female dancer, which we actually cut in our production because we don't have dancers in our production. I think that was the Elizabethan notion of they would end these productions with a sort of celebration, and then a member of the company would step out. And in the epilogue, the young dancer says, "Bear with us, Sir John Falstaff will return in the next play." So I think that was Shakespeare also writing that for the sake of the queen who loved Falstaff. And that, you know, the lore is that at the end of this play, she was upset about the, you know, the turning away of Falstaff, and that she asked Shakespeare to commission The Merry Wives of Windsor, or a play revolving around Falstaff. So he wrote this sort of yarn about Falstaff, you know, in a much more comic situation than he's already in. But,
or it could have been an editor who decided to add that.
Yes. Yeah.
Right.
Very much.
I mean,
yeah.
We don't know. We don't
have. That's the other thing about it is we don't know. There's scholarship on it left and right, but the true historical notion, we have no idea. Yeah.
Okay. So to the audience for comments or questions about Henry IV, and if you have any thing you want to ask Brian or tell him how to direct it in a different way, which sometimes happens here at the festival.
It's too early for that. Please don't tell me that.
Well, yeah, okay.
Oh, I can take it. Come on.
We'll see what happens. There is a large audience here today, and I know we look to get the microphone to everybody that we can, so please help us if you have a comment or a question. Raise your hand and Brian and I will make sure that it gets passed as long as the person holding it doesn't hold onto it for dear life, and
sure
will agree to pass it on. So yes, go ahead.
All right. So we've been coming for years and years.
Hi, yes. Hi.
And I'm going to expose Brian here to everyone. He gave my daughter, Christina, her first kiss. He was in the Green Show. He used to dance on top of barrels. And he was the man who was in charge of the salt at Henry. He was the minion in charge of the salt.
At
King Henry's feast. Yep. And in order to get salt to your table, you had to go and kiss the salt bearer, who was Brian. So Christina, our darling daughter, who was terribly embarrassed, went and kissed Brian.
There might be many more young ladies around.
I'm sure.
Sad to say for them. I'm sorry. Yeah.
All right. So I have to say I had such low expectations because Henry IV Part II is not Henry V and, you know, all these wonderful things. I was moved to tears by the scene between Hal and his father. And I just thought it was wonderful. I felt like it really actually brought it all together for me. The abandoning of his wicked ways mm-hmm. and Falstaff at the end, which he had to do in order to become great.
Yeah.
You know, it's very poignant.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it's what, you know, that scene in the play, I think, is really the you know, the sort of epicenter in this play, that moment, also the turning away of Falstaff, which is a main climax of the play. But the scene with the father and the son is the road that was to Finn Red Tapestry. About did Shakespeare initially think it was going to be written in two parts, you know, and but knowing that the story is so vast and so large that over time he was like, I gotta break this down. You know, the events up to the Battle of Shrewsbury in itself are massive. And you know, he also put Hotspur in there, which is this incredibly dynamic character. And what the wake of that is after his passing. But this play, I agree. In fact, it's one of the scenes when I watch it, having played Hal, but not done Part Two, that I'm very envious of, because it really does not only provide a great platform for the actors dramatically, and especially for these two actors who have sort of been through this journey together, but also it really, really helps the playgoer, the reader, get the motive behind Hal and the sense of him having to have a father-son moment, you know, that is not about leadership anymore, but it's about my father who's passing away. And, you know, that's one of the reasons I wanted to remove the crown there at the one moment and have that sort of a way that it becomes no longer the wall between them anymore. That it's the thing that Hal will have to, of course, pick up and adopt and take on, which you see in the scene after that scene to great effect with the Lord Chief Justice. But that scene right there is really about understanding between a parent and a child, both the mistakes that they have both made, as well as the understanding of who they are together and how that influences each of them. It's very profound, and I agree. So I'm very happy that it resonated to such great effect. And, you know, those guys have been really fabulous to work with. The other thing in this play that's very odd is, you know, Hal's only in very little of this play. It's really Falstaff's play in many ways, that turning away of Falstaff and the slow demise of him. And when he comes back, you can really feel that sense of going, okay, here's the guy. This is what's he going to do here? How is he going to? And all of these plays have been sort of culminating to that moment since Henry usurping the crown from Richard. It's all culminates to, well, what's going to happen next? And that's the fabulous, I think, exploration of all these plays as they sit together, about who these people are and what it means to hold that title and how to use it when they do hold it. Very deft and very, it's very moving to me. And to know that a playwright was examining that at the time, I think is very resonant for our contemporary society also.
And of course, last year for those of you who saw Henry IV Part One, Hal does tell Falstaff that he will turn his back on him.
Yeah.
And so we get to see it after we've heard about it previously. But I was thinking as you were talking, if there was anyone here that had never seen any of the Henry plays until last night, how they might access just this play. And I don't know if anyone's here that applies to, but it would be interesting to think just seeing that play by itself. It's only been presented here one other time, of course, presented in the trilogy a lot of times.
Yeah.
But just taking it on its own, very different than when you have the background.
Yeah. And you know, another thing I want to just sort of for you to recognize is the sense of justice that I was talking about is really manifested in these two characters of the Lord Chief Justice and Justice Shallow on the other end of the side of the spectrum. Falstaff's sense of justice there, somebody he's grown up with, they've known each other the whole time, and yet he's still trying to fleece the justice, he's still trying to get something out of him. And the same thing is happening with Hal, and the Lord Chief Justice is trying to rein him in under his father's wishes, and then begins to gradually say, you are right. He says in the play, you are right, justice. And I think that is both literal and metaphorical about him saying it to the person and the sense of justice in itself, of him taking that on, pledging to him that he will go forth with that, and adopting that sense of being in himself. Is the play sort of working on two levels? That's the sort of meta theatrical moment, I think, in the play a little bit. It's also in this particular production, the Lord Chief Justice, I've combined with another role in Shakespeare's play. There's a character of Warwick that is in the show, and it was primarily because of cast size, to be quite honest, about trying to trim and sort of, you know, put the play in a little bit more concise offering. And I did trim some scenes. I moved Henry's first entrance, the king's entrance, actually doesn't come until much later in the play, and I wanted his presence a little bit earlier in the play, so we got a sense of what was going on with him. But I combined the Lord Chief Justice and Warwick because I also felt that there was something really beautiful about the sense of, here's a man who is literally like a police officer of the state, who also understands the psychological journey of the king's son, of saying, do not worry, I know that he will turn over. And yet at the same time is also going, I think that's going to happen. But trying to convince the king that there's a bit of this prophetic quality to him about people coming to a culmination in their life where they know that they're going to have to take one step or the other step. And his believing in how, I also like that. I thought that was very human about somebody who sees stuff very black and white, also knowing that somebody has the potential to change. And so that, I think, has been really great to explore with Jamie Newcomb in this part. And I think that's just very human and immediate.
And isn't the Lord Chief Justice one of the few characters that doesn't have a name?
Yeah.
He's called Justice, but he doesn't have another name.
Yeah, yeah, yep. Which is another symbolic thing, you know, that it's that sense of him being there. He's also represented sort of in part one. You know, this is another thing that Shakespeare does in this play. All of a sudden, he starts introducing these new characters that we haven't seen. Shallow, Pistol. You know, in the next play, we're going to meet Nim in Henry V. He comes into the tavern. And then all those characters are also going to be folded into Merry Wives later. So you can see the playwright kind of going, oh, we got to... Also, the brothers, you know, the brothers aren't in part one at all. And some productions put them in, and I didn't in our production because I was just going off of what was in the text. John is in part one, but he's not in... But then all four of them are in part two. And that's another thing that I wonder if Shakespeare's like, oh, well, let's try to... I can finesse this a little more. I can make this a little bit fuller.
Or he had some actors in his company that said, come on,
yeah, yeah,
give me a role.
Yeah, right. Maybe. Yeah, exactly. All right, you can be the son over here. And yeah.
Okay. Yes. So the first time I saw Falstaff kind of making his own journey, I was really taken with the characterization of the exhilaration that he felt when Hal became king. And then the rapid descent into despair, mm-hmm, when he was curbed in public, and then the grasping at straws. He'll call for me, something will happen, something will change, yeah, and then nothing changes, and the final despair, he's just finished. And
yeah,
that was his journey, rapid
yeah,
and distinctive.
Well, it's these, you know, these elements of youth and innocence also, which I think are really interesting in the play. The memory aspect of these characters, of recalling days gone by and these times where they were living in a place of just freedom and excess. And with Falstaff, you see him sort of denying even the memory, or trying to deny the memory a little bit. But it is a man who's kind of grasping at straws in the final days of his life. And the hope that he might have something with Hal is that it, you know, the beautiful thing that Shakespeare's woven in here is that we all know that's not going to happen. We all know that. It can't happen. But how that Falstaff is still holding on to that inkling of the potential for greatness in a way that he can, as he says, turn diseases to commodity. He can find something, gain, volume, excess in his relationship with him is really beautiful, because I think everybody has had that sense of hope in their life that they want to deny the reality of what's going on. And then it comes and it smacks you in the face. And it's tragic. And this is exactly what happens in the play, in that final moment of him turning away. And Hal also offers him, you know, a little bit of a feather there at the end, and a sense of hope there, of saying, if you do turn yourself around, come see me again and we can offer you advancement, as he says. I think he knows full well that that will probably never happen. And as the Justice Shallow says to him, this is something that you will die in, Sir John. And it is. That's what Quickly says in part in Henry V, that the king has killed his heart. And that's the thing that shatters Falstaff, is the heart. Falstaff's an amazing character. You know, Harold Bloom, it's like his favorite character, Harold Bloom, the famous, you know, scholar who's written some fabulous books about Shakespeare. But the creation of Falstaff being the embodiment of life, which he even says in part one, give me life, you know, you don't see a whole lot in literature, somebody embracing that side of things. And he's so witty. And he, in this play, he has that beautiful speech about how sack informs a sense of being, you know, which is both ironic and just twisted, you know. But also, Hal takes a little bit of that on, you know, him drinking with his buddies in the tavern gives him valor and mettle and a sense of camaraderie with his fellow man that his father does not have. His father has a cold and calculated heart that is wrapped around fear and what is going to happen. And Hal begins to take on both of those a little bit, and that becomes the next play.
You probably just answered the question I was going to ask, which was, what is your take on Harold Bloom's idea that this play is about Falstaff?
I think that's right. I mean, I do think it's about all of them, but I do think he's got more lines in the play than anybody. He has more scenes in the play than anybody. So Shakespeare's telling you something here, you know, by that. He would not have him so prominently featured if that were the case. And it is, again, a man who is trying to weave his way, and it's falling apart. He's battered. He's got gout. He's sick. He's old. He recognizes it. He's hanging out with whores. He's got disease. You know, that's the whole disease stuff in the play, which is dark and disturbing and yet a reality. And then Hal comes into that tavern all of a sudden, and there's this burst of life, hope, possibility that quickly gets squelched and is also not the same as it was before, because people change and Falstaff does not change.
You've already said very eloquently that it's...
Go ahead and hold it really close.
That it's Falstaff's play. But it's also the play of the people in the tavern. So we get this double reaction to the death of the king. I mean, we have Hal is devastated by it. And in the tavern, yippee, woohoo, a good time, start ahead. There's an awful lot of, and there's the recruiting scene. I mean, there are a lot of low characters in this play. Where do we identify here? There's a lot of it.
Yeah, there is. Well, and again, it's Falstaff, you know, as a he's come into good fortune a little bit by claiming to have, you know, killed Hotspur, and so he's come into some pension there and been rewarded. So there's a sense of him already puffed up, but then they have to go to this pending battle that's coming between the Archbishop of York and Hastings and that side, and possibly Northumberland, who doesn't end up showing up. But Falstaff begins to, you know, recruit these soldiers, and he recruits the lowest forms of life because he knows he can get money out of them, and that they will become, as he says in part one, food for powder, that they're just, it doesn't matter. They're the dregs of society, so put them on the front lines and then let them die. And there's a beautiful moment in this play where the one character that everybody thinks, the woman's tailor, that becomes something that is not, you know, not the chivalry, not the Hotspur of the world, not the knight, who says, we owe God a death. And if my duty is to go to the front lines, I'm going to go to the front lines. And even these other soldiers are trying to buy their way out of it, who are the most capable men. Bullcalf, the biggest, strongest guy there, gives, I want some money to get away from this. I don't want to go. And here you have this person that is identified as almost a caricature, who says probably the most profound and beautiful thing in the play, which is, if it is our duty to go, it is our duty to go and support our nation and our king. So all of that, I think, is true, and I agree with you 100% that it is an examination of the people. And without that examination, we would not understand Henry V's journey in that play of recruiting all these different people from England to overcome the French in a completely outnumbered situation where he tries to unify them. And, you know, the boy is really an archetype in this play also, as a watcher, and somebody who is like Hal in the sense, and we'll see in Henry V what happens with the boy, that I really wanted to sort of establish that the boy becomes, Prince Hal gives Falstaff the page. And in many ways, he becomes a manifestation of Hal for Falstaff, a young squire who's got potential and understanding. And even the squire himself later begins to push that world aside. Is symbolic and rich. I mean, it's so yes, it shares that sensibility that it is not only about the kingdom and the court and the hierarchy of the kingdom, but the people that are living within it and the repercussions of their actions for those people also. Henry says to his son and on the death on his deathbed is busy giddy minds with foreign quarrels. That action hence borne out will deter the memory of the past. To move forward, you have to have a cause. And I think Hal hears that, which we'll see.
I'm going to say something out of turn. Sorry, but I can't help it. However magical Henry V will be, and however wonderful Sam Ashdown will be, and he will be, it will not have the magic of the Adams Theatre, and I do not understand why this is not designated as a precious historic building and why it isn't there for posterity.
Understood. That's a whole other conversation.
you can lead the charge.
Yeah, it is a... Yes, I know, you know... She was talking about the Adams, about preserving the Adams as an iconic, you know, historical building. Yes, I know, right? It's a whole other seminar.
Looking at the Henry IV plays as precursors for Henry V, you have Prince Hal become king, and he leads his country on an invasion of France. He tries throughout the play of Henry V to justify it morally. He partially succeeds, but partially doesn't. Do you see anything in Prince Hal's young life that led to this compulsion to invade France on a morally ambiguous campaign?
Well, I think it's the quest for identity. And I think I kind of touched on that a little bit earlier. You know, the first thing he says in Henry V is, may I with right and noble conscience make this claim? And I think the sense of conscience is really what he's trying to go for. The peace of mind to know that this is right to pursue. And that, again, is his journey through the whole thing, right and wrong. Falstaff embodies wrong. His father is trying to embody the right. But even that is questionable, his father's actions. You see that with John, becomes a product in this play, a very calculated military move that, you know, sways a peace offering. He goes and beheads them. That's villainous in many ways, and especially in the code of war, which you will see also in Henry V. And that's, I think, some of the debatable actions about Henry as the warrior king and the choices that he makes in doing that. But it becomes this quest for my name in a divine right of king's world. Do I still, is it, should I be sitting in this place? And there is that thread that's there, but it does become questionable. And I think that that's the thing that he goes through the journey. That's why I think he's reluctant to embody it. That's why I think he's upset at his father for usurping the crown. It's sort of swaying this thing that has been a part of England, divine right of kings, that all of a sudden somebody says, my line is more right. I claim this title. I need to take this. And then with military might, basically steals the crown from Richard II and says, now this is the Lancaster name. And then the offspring of that, now having to pick up the mantle and go forward, is definitely one rich with, I hope that this is right.
Yeah, and I suppose the question that I was struggling with is, couldn't Hal just have stayed in England and established himself as their rightful king of England? What is it that made him invade France?
Well, I think it's both that, the claim for that line, the French line to his name, and also what his father says in this, which is busy, giddy minds with foreign quarrels. Give your nation a task to get them off of the anarchy and the sort of robbery and rebellion that's happening, the internal anarchy that's going on in the kingdom. That's the thing that you see in this play, is that Henry's entire reign was fraught with people trying to take him over from all forms of England, Welsh, the Scottish. There were rebellious factions happening left and right through his entire reign. He spent most of his money on trying to keep people at bay. And that's, I think, what he says to Hal, is unify your nation with an external cause to go forward. And that's what Hal hears in this play. So I think it's both the combination for that, as well as him having a firm identity as a king of England in a world that is changing from a divine right of king sensibility.
Another thing to remember is that Shakespeare wrote this play for an audience that knew the story of Henry V, and it had happened, 15th century. This play is 16th century. So Shakespeare gives us reasons in the play through the character of Hal to an audience that would know about what had happened. So it isn't, if we're just looking at it as not knowing anything about history, which is possible in a play, but think about who his audience was and who was on the throne at that time, Queen Elizabeth, and why did he write this history play? And there are a lot of people standing. If there is an extra seat by you, could you raise your hand and let these people come and sit down by you? Okay, where's the mic? Yes, go ahead.
Okay, I've got one comment to make. I think having Henry V, the change, the new stuff in the new theater is going to be awesome too. I love the old theater, but I think that's going to be it's a really good play to have in the new theater. So I'm sorry, I'm going to become very unpopular. Also,
thank you. I agree.
I
love it. I think the theatricality of that play, as well as what it says, that's exactly what we're launching off with in that space because of that very thing.
Okay, I will leave quietly. But you're sounding as though you are going to be the director, please.
I think so, yes. I mean, it just hasn't been announced yet, but okay. I would really love to do it, obviously especially to work with both Larry or Sam and possibly Larry. we still haven't figured all that out, but just to sort of continue this journey, I think, for me personally, even, is sort of like, the final, cool nugget of that. We'll see.
I did have a question. How did you approach, it's sort of a side story, but I think it's very important. Hotspur's father is running away. He had a convenient illness, and then he runs away to Scotland. How did you feel? I thought you did a great job of the Hotspur's wife is the one who seems to be more valor. She's got valor. She's got grit in her. Mm-hmm. But he talks a good game, but he was going away, running away. How did you feel about that?
Well, I think, you know, it's a pivotal role in the, especially in the tetralogy of plays, knowing that Northumberland was there when Balling, you know, he was a part of Richard's court, left Richard, sided with Bolingbroke. And then even Bolingbroke's, then he sort of began to shift from Bolingbroke, and his son sort of took over the sense of the, you know, the rebellious idea. And I think in many ways he kind of took a back seat to his son because his son's valor exceeded anybody's valor. But the fact that he did not show up to support his son in a numbers game, essentially, of bringing more troops to support this cause, shows his fear of Henry's arm here. And it's one of the things in the play that we talked a lot about in those scenes, that if they don't do anything, they're still going to be at risk. Because if they defeat Henry, fabulous. If they don't defeat him, he's going to kill them. If they don't go to war, he's going to kill them, because they're already traitors to the nation. And this, I think, is the conundrum that Northumberland is in. And having lost his son, knowing that he did not show up, is, again, this moment, I think, of pure guilt that is just rooted in him about the deception of his own family, of not embracing his son in a time of need. And that's the thing that Lady Percy throws in his face. And the interesting thing is she says, don't go to the battle, no more of this, which tells you that, you know, she herself doesn't agree with it per se, but that through that whole thing, she says, it is your fault that he went in the first place at the Battle of Shrewsbury, that you left him, you denied him. And if you continue to do, you know, even if you do go, you're still going to get screwed no matter what, basically, I think is what it comes down to. Pardon my language, so blunt, but that's what it essentially is. And yeah, she does embody Hotspur there in that scene. She takes on all of the qualities of Hotspur there, which is valor, strength. Hotspur's biggest problem is that he's not necessarily the most tactile, strategic leader. He is drawn by conviction, and that drives him. And that's the thing that Northumberland embodies, is a strategic mind, and him knowing that they're probably not going to win by throwing his son to the fire is dramatically profound and heartbreaking, I think. So it's a significant threat in this play, especially because the threat needs to be there. And then once again, he takes on a cowardly sense of being by not going forward. And yet at the same time, you can't help but feel that Lady Percy is right. Don't go. It's not worth dying for. It's not worth our name being destroyed to go forward. This is a cause that is going to give no means, you know. And he hears that from her. But it takes that, also that powerful female voice in this play, voice of reason, for him to go, I think you're right, okay, let's, I'll fly to Scotland. That was another reason I didn't want to, you know, I was thinking about cutting Lady Northumberland. It's the first time you see her, but it's so powerful to me to have these two female characters in there who are like, you have messed up. You are completely wrong here. You are wrong. And letting that sway him, unlike Hotspur being swayed by Lady Percy in the first play, which she tries to do, but Hotspur is pig-headed and hard-headed, and he doesn't hear it. He's a horse with blinders on.
When I was reading the play last week, I was struck by the significance of the Chief Justice, of course, and also the Archbishop, and I was hoping like heck that some really strong actors would be cast in those two roles. So my compliments for your choice of Tony Amendola and James Newcomb, of course, in those roles.
Thank you.
And I also look forward to seeing how the scene would play out, how Newcomb and Hal would deal with the sequence where Newcomb's character, after Hal's become king, and Newcomb's character is probably thinking Well, I know he's thinking, I don't have anything to lose here. I'm probably going to get killed.
Yeah.
So I might as well go down saying what I think and stand true to my principles and all that. And I was really impressed by the way Newcomb chose to basically speak to a king in a way that, well, the play calls for it, I guess, but that he chose to speak to a king in a way in which a person wouldn't normally speak to a king. Yeah. That you'd be risked with a with an inferior king, you'd be risking your life talking to him the way he does.
And oh yeah,
that particular moment, I got the feeling that Hal actually seemed like a king during that sequence, and I found that impressive that he took everything the chief justice had to say and then told him he was right.
Yeah,
and not every king would have done that. Anyway,
I agree. I think I'm glad you recognize that too, because you're exactly right. He faces, you know, the front lines there, the Lord Chief Justice, that the consequences could completely have gone the other way. And the beauty of Hal there is that he hears him and he knows that, as he says, you are right, I am wrong. And unlike his father, who probably would have been like, push them away, push them aside, because I'm afraid. And at the end of that scene, also, Hal says something that war or peace or both can exist. And I think that's the difference between Hal. And I think it's because of his being able to straddle these two worlds of the court and the tavern, the common man and, you know, the hierarchy. I don't think you would have seen that possibly with another king. Certainly not with Richard III, you know. They would have been like off of his head, you know. How dare you speak to me like that in front of all these other people, in front of your brothers. But that's a change that's beginning to happen. And everybody hears it and can go forward. And that's what's great about it. You know, it becomes a much more diplomatic sense of leadership.
It's also interesting to think about Queen Elizabeth seeing this play and having that character talk to the king that way. Is Shakespeare also saying perhaps Queen Elizabeth is someone who will listen to the people in her court? I don't know, but I don't think Shakespeare would have put it in the play if he didn't think he had a ear of the person on the throne.
Just a quick question, and I'll pass this along, I promise. When you were deciding on the order in which you were going to produce the Shakespeare plays, I know the goal is to produce them all within like 14 years, something like that.
Yeah.
Did you actually give any thought to having Richard II before Henry IV, part one, given the chronology, or?
Well, we did, actually. I mean, part of within that Complete the Canon initiative is to present the history plays in succession. And we did present Richard II. We presented it in our fall season, not last season, season before. And then King John we had out here. So yes, that is strategic on our part to show them all in succession in chronological order, knowing that we jump time, you know, obviously.
I'd forgotten about the fall. I didn't get to see that.
Okay. I know, you know, Richard II. I love Richard II. I think it's one of the most beautifully written. I mean, the verse in the play is extraordinary.
Tell them who you played in that.
I played Northumberland, actually, in that production. David played Richard, and Henry Warnitz, who played Falstaff last season, had directed that production. And it was a great experience, actually, and it was great doing it inside a little bit in a different setting. And yes, these plays all inform one another, definitely.
Question, I've got the mic over, way over on the side. I know you had originally planned to have the same Falstaff this year, and that didn't happen for a number of reasons.
Right.
Did you try and have any continuity between the new Falstaff and Henry Warnitz last year, or did you just let him be his own Falstaff? What did you do?
Yeah, I mean, we talked a great deal. You know, John Aline, who plays Falstaff, I had the great pleasure to work with him this last year in Orlando doing Merry Wives of Windsor, and he played Falstaff in that production. And then after talking with Henry, you know, Henry, of course, was signed on to do the show and had some personal stuff that was going on in his life that he was unable to be with us. And, you know, I gave him our blessing and vice versa. And I'm still in great contact with Henry. And But yes, his decisions in that play definitely influenced the relationship, especially with Hal in that and about the two of them. John has been really fabulous about bringing his own sense of understanding of the character, having played it many times prior, which I love, as well as being able to thread in some of this other elements in this production, primarily a lot of the darker elements of it that I was really trying to capture, of him getting lost in the memory, getting lost in the possibility that he's, going to fall away. But John is picking up the helm really great. He kind of is John Falstaff. I mean, he's a wonderful guy, and I'm really happy to have him in the company. And very fortunate because of the circumstances. You know, at first it was like, oh my gosh, we don't have, what am I going to do? But he's really just dove right in, and everybody has embraced him with loving arms. And his understanding of the plays has been the thing that I think has been the most significant in moving forward. And receptive to many things.
Did you work with him at Orlando Shakes?
Yeah, I did. And in Merry Wives. And
Brian directed Merry Wives of Windsor at Orlando Shakes. And he was your Falstaff,
correct? He was. Merry Wives is a very different play. And it was set in the 1950s, sort of a sitcom, I Love Lucy type production, and was a lot of fun. And John was great. But even in that, I saw also the other quality of Falstaff, which is the bombastic, sort of darker, grittier side. In Merry Wives, he's a lot more kind of, he's playing a lover, he's trying to woo these two ladies. But there's also this sort of thread of darkness that I wanted in this play, which I think is more woven in, about a guy who is a scavenger and trying to find anything he can to survive. And John was very receptive to that.
Did you ever think for even 1/100th of a second of having part two be a sitcom?
No. Yeah, I know, right? Yeah. Well, there's some of it is just kind of like, what is going on? There are moments in the tavern, the Falstaff world is that sense of light and dark. They trod the lines, and some of it is absolutely nutty, and these characters are. So I can see that if you dialed it up in another way, it could have a sitcom-y element. I mean, sitcom sort of, extended reality, a little bit heightened reality in some ways, but not so much the neon. No, no. Yeah, maybe a split second, a minuscule. No. He would, right? Pistol could have his own sitcom, actually, right? Yes. Would have subtitles probably for a lot of it. What is he saying?
Oh, you're getting to the subject I had as my question. I really enjoyed the scenes between Falstaff and Shallow. And I just thought the two were terrific together. One of the things that struck me was that at least the first scene when they were together, is I was reminded of a 50s sitcom in some way.
Yeah.
It felt more modern. It felt more relaxed. There were no declamations, no loud voices, no yelling. My question is, I really had two parts. Number one, just to comment on the interaction between the two.
Sure.
But also, how does the role of the director and the actors change if you did change the time and the era and try to present this in a more modern way? What would happen to the voices? What would happen in such a situation?
Well, I think that's that's a conceptual idea, I think, and whoever helms such an idea, for me, it's always about how that structure is going to make the play resonate in that structure, and without sacrificing what the play is. And that sometimes is the tricky thing that I think sometimes doesn't work conceptually. Sometimes you go, well, that worked for me, but this didn't. So it takes a lot of thought to do that, to bring it into a different time period or a different style. That's usually just a conceptual thing. Because we're in a completely Elizabethan setting out here, to take this play outside of the Elizabethan, for me personally, would not work, because it's very much a product about an Elizabethan examination, actually, of the 15th century. That's the other thing. Shakespeare's writing about the past, but it's a contemporary offering for them at the time. Is Shakespeare presenting this to his contemporaries? But to sort of take that, I don't think it would work under the confines of this particular structure in the outdoor setting. So for me, that wasn't the case. As far as the shallow Falstaff stuff, you know, it's again that's verse of prose versus verse in the language. All that stuff is in prose, and those that don't know what that is, it's not in meter, it's not in iambic pentameter, so it's lighter, it's looser. And there are some characters that speak verse and they speak prose. Hal, one of them, when he goes into the tavern, he speaks in prose, and that shows you a character who is able to bounce back and forth, both in a sense of rhetoric as well as their persona. And then the verse is more formal and more structured, and you see that with a lot more formal characters in the play. And that's the beauty of the poetry of the language, that it helps establish the hierarchy of these characters. That scene is exactly in prose, it's lighthearted. I was just saying the other day in our rehearsal, we had a rain stage rehearsal, the shallow silent stuff is a very Mutt and Jeff type thing. It's like kind of, it's a little bit of banter, you know, it's just two guys talking about the good old days and the days gone by. And then Falstaff comes into that. And if it were in verse, it would lose that sense of a relaxed state of being. And that's a perfect examination of that type of scene working within those confines.
Okay, you get the final comment or question of the hour.
I'm looking toward the future, and I'm very excited about the fact that I guess in 2 or 3 years you'll be doing starting the Henry the Sixth trilogy.
Yeah,
and
me too.
And I'm excited because it's so rarely put on, and I used to think this is just because it was an early play and it's not as accomplished maybe as some of the later histories.
Yeah.
But having reread them recently, they're really fantastic plays, even if they aren't quite as good as, say, Henry V.
Oh, yeah.
But it seems to me now that perhaps the main reason they're not put on is because they have a cast of thousands.
Yeah.
First of all, do you agree that more than the fact that it's an early play is the reason they're not put on? And if so, how do you plan to address the problem that it requires so many people?
Yeah, I think, first of all, that's a very acute, observation. They're big plays. There's a lot of characters. And I do think some theater companies get scared of that when it's, you know, the producing costs of putting on a play. It's like, well, how many characters are you going to have? How many characters are going to be doubling, tripling, quadrupling characters? What that does for your costume budget? All that stuff needs to come into play. And I also think they scare people because some people don't want to do the work in trying to bring them from the page to the stage because it's unfamiliar to them. That's just my own personal feeling on that. I agree with you. They're completely rich and amazing. While they're not, it's not Midsummer Night's Dream, and it does take a little bit of work for the playgoer, they are very, very resonant. And there's some fabulous characters in the Henry VI's, Joan of Arc being one of them. You begin to see Richard III before he's Richard III in Jack Cade's Rebellion. I mean, there's a lot of really prominent things. Henry VI himself, which is the offspring of Henry V. And when you see them over time, one of the things that I really love is you see somebody who is the sense of how these rulers also embody the church and a sense of the hierarchy of the church over their rule. When you look at that over the arc of them all, Henry Hal's adoption of using the word God becomes very, very present in Henry V. And he takes it on in Henry IV a little bit. This I swear to God that I will do this. He begins to take that on a little bit. His offspring, Henry VI, becomes a very, very pious ruler. And what that becomes. So I agree. I love them. I think they're great. And there's three of them. And sometimes that's okay. How are we going to do this? And we are still contemplating doing them in two parts, possibly. We're contemplating putting them in the same season so that people may be able to see all of them played out in one fell swoop, or you might be able to see the breadth of them in one day. That's the greatness of these plays also. But yes, they're challenging because they're large. And the cost of putting on a play sometimes expensive. I can guarantee you that there will be doubling and tripling of roles. You know, you have 20 actors, 22, and you've got 60 some odd characters. Like, well, okay, I'm going to be doubling here. You know, that's where the hair and makeup team comes in. It's like, oh, there's a beard. Oh, there's a mustache. Oh, there's chops. Oh, there's a wig. There's, yeah.
Well, it's been a very wonderful hour with Brian Vaughn, director, actor, artistic director.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Continue to come see us.
Thank you all very much for being here. I've neglected to mention last hour, there will be an actor seminar today here at 11 a.m. But first, we will take a quick break, get off the benches, and then David Ivers will be here to talk about Charlie's Aunt. Thank you so much for being here.